Hey, welcome to Red May, your 1 month vacation from capitalism. We're about two thirds of the way through our program. It's 43 separate events, maybe 110 different guest speakers. I'd like to kind of clue you into some of what's happening in the next 5 or 6 days. Aziz, could you throw up the Friday program here on somewhere where I can read it? Well, maybe I'll start with Saturday and we'll get back to, oh yeah, good. All right, so tomorrow at 3 p.m., Lux starting a socialist feminist women's magazine with Sarah Leonard, Marion Jones, Tammy Kim, Cheryl Rivera, and Charanya Dervasula. Tomorrow at 6 p.m., we have is it 5 p.m.? I think I got this wrong. We changed it. I believe this is 5 p.m. Theorizing the Present, the Revolutionary Foresight of Black Communist Women, with Charisse Burden-Stelly and Jody Dean and Ashley Farmer as the moderator. Then we go into our weekend with Spectre Journal. They present a panel on the Paris Commune 150 years on, that's at 11 a.m. And it has Stathis Kouvalakis, Carolyn Eichner, and Zach Levinson as the moderator. At 3 p.m., Paul North and Paul Ryder talk about the new translation of Capital that they're working on. Eva Osorio Ruiz is the moderator to that. And at 11 a.m. on Sunday, We Still Want Everything. It's the 50th anniversary of the novel We Want Everything by Nanni Balestrini, the Italian autonomist and avant-garde figure. We will have Maria Teresa Carbone, Rachel Kushner, Franco Bifo Berardi, and Jasper Burns as the moderator. And then at 2 p.m., Spectre Journal is going to do another panel called Class Struggle and Racial Justice After the Union Drive at Amazon in Alabama. We'll analyze what happened there and what we can look for in the future. We have David McNally, Mike Goldfield, and Donna Murch for that one. And finally, at 5 p.m. on Sunday, Value, Capitalism, and Communism, Jasper Burns, Cordelia Belton, and Kailash Srinivasan. So then we have two well-deserved days off, we'll be back on Wednesday with our last week of programming. How do we do it? We must have a wealthy patron behind us, right? Because as you probably surmised, there isn't a lot of support. There isn't any institutional support for a festival, one of whose slogans is be a commie for a month, at least not in America. They don't fund those festivals. You have to fund it. We need your support. And we have various ways that you can demonstrate it. One is our GoFundMe, which is Fan the Flames of Red May. You'll find a link to that in the YouTube description of this event. You can also find it on our website, www.redmayseattle.org, under donate. You can also find under donate our Patreon. You can become a patron at the level of $3 a month, $5 a month, $10, or $20. So lots of options. Please help us with your generosity. We're like Blanche DuBois, we depend on the kindness of strangers. But now I wanna go inaugurate this event, which I've been really looking forward to, as I am both a moderator on it and a presenter. The panel is called How to Weaponize or Defuse a Constitution. And I'm very happy to have brought together three other panelists who have all written great books with which take absolutely kind of different angles to approach this same subject. With the subject, we might call it constitutional deadlock or sclerotic or total stasis. I mean, how relevant that is to America, we might think now, when the famous second impeachment of Donald Trump never got beyond the legal protocols of whether, in fact, one should or should not have an impeachment. One doesn't vote on the substance of the event or the substance of anything. One votes on the legal protocols. When you've reached that point, you've reached absolute entropy. So we want to go back and look at this from various angles. And I want to invite first Aziz Rana, sorry, who's the author who teaches law at Cornell and is the author of two wonderful books. One, The Two Faces of Freedom, you can buy now. The other one called, is it Constitutional Veneration? Or what's the...
It's going to be called Rise of the Constitution.
The Rise of the Constitution.
Okay. Still in process, but hopefully soon.
It's being written, but it's all there. I mean, there'll be edits, but it's there and it's great. So I turn it over to you as the first speaker.
Well, so first, thank you so much, Philip, Mahim, Stephen, all of the organizers. It's a real pleasure to be here and to be on this wonderful panel with all of these great speakers and some really terrific books that I strongly recommend that folks go out and seek out from both Camila and Richard. I think what I'm going to do for my time is explore a real kind of disjuncture that we're seeing in this moment, that if you grew up in the United States in the late 20th century, at the beginning of this century, you would have been taught a pretty familiar story about the Constitution, which is it's a near ideal distillation of liberal democratic principles. And for the most part, if you had any conversations or followed the news about the Constitution, that discussion would have concerned the Supreme Court and a fairly heroic and mythic presentation of the members of the Supreme Court at that. And that was basically the framing. And yet today, I think you see an emerging discussion on the left, but really even beyond the left, that's looking at the structure of constitutional decision-making, the design of the basic institutions, and raising some pretty profound questions about the extent to which the constitutional order is itself fundamentally undemocratic. Indeed, I think it's become a kind of left liberal conventional wisdom that the constitutional system facilitates minority rule, is, you know, a central antagonist, frankly, in our various efforts at meaningful social change. And along with facilitating minority rule, entrenches a particular version of white authoritarianism. So, you know, how is it that we reached the point where institutions that are this broken could have been deified for so long? And what should we make of it in the present in terms of our own projects of meaningful transformation? So let me start by just giving a bit of an historical background about how we got to where we are. And then I'll end by just, you know, reflecting a little bit on what that suggests about our own current moment. 100 years ago, the critiques that have been circulating recently about the Constitution would have been very familiar. So it's a period of, not unlike our own, intense inequality and class conflict, as well as sustained white supremacy and therefore racial strife. And it's a time in which there's deep disillusionment with the constitutional system. There's a sense that the constitutional order, especially when it comes to unelected lifetime judges, sustains the interests of an elite class of business activists and business actors. And that the one tool that most people have, the working class and folks that are poor, is the power of the vote. And yet we have a system that systematically fractures voting power while proliferating a series of veto points that allows effectively an invisible government to control political decision-making. And in this context, you had a socialist discourse that spread beyond just the labor left and labor radicals to influence the academy, as well as progressive reformers that argued that the country needed a fundamentally different theory of constitutional design. The mode of constitutional design that the 1787 constitutional system had set up was one in which there was a massive gulf between ordinary political decision-making and constitutional decision-making because of how hard it was to amend the text. It was a system in which all of these checks and balances made it very, very difficult for popular votes to have meaningful influence. There were limited rights provisions, very few positive socioeconomic rights, and it was a very short text. And so there was a call for a different mode of constitutional politics with a simplified amendment process, with a parliamentary system built around proportional representation, multi-member districts, with far more extensive positive economic rights provisions that were written into the text, with a document really that looked a lot more like a legislative document, and indeed much more like the constitutions that emerged ultimately in the second half of the 20th century in the global South, where the US Constitution is 7,000 words. The average constitution today is 20,000 words. The US Constitution is viewed as maybe the hardest in the world to reform. And part of the socialist critique of the constitutional system at the time was based on the idea that one could not separate institutions of decision-making from ultimate political outcomes. In other words, socialists in particular had a vision. Sometimes they called it the cooperative commonwealth, but at root, it was the idea that there should be a fundamentally different social order based on genuine democratic control of both political and economic decision-making, in which capitalism was fundamentally transformed into a very different system of property ownership and distribution of material spoils. And they argue that such socialist outcomes were not made impossible by the existing institutions, but the existing institutions put a massive thumb on the scales of those with power, such that the institution shaped the viability of policy outcomes, and that these two things couldn't be separated. You actually needed to have a constitutional politics, one built on reform, in order to produce socialist ends because of the ways in which effectively process and substance were linked. Now, one of the things that's really interesting about this during this period is it meant that even in the academy, the influence of this critique of the constitutional system suggested that the places where you should study the Constitution would be in political science departments, in history departments, because what you're most interested in was the organization of government and how that came to be. And indeed, a common brand of constitutional study during the period would be what we would call originalism today, a focus on, well, what is it that the founders intended and how did that develop a particular kind of text? And perhaps the most famous of these originalists was somebody named Charles Beard, who developed an economic theory of the constitutional system that said that the framers of the Constitution were committed to an anti-democratic politics because of their own class orientation, and that a class analysis of the founding tells us much about how the institutions had emerged and developed. And so history here was being used to engage in a form of critique, and it was history and political science where you studied the Constitution. Well, how did this change? There are three kind of decisive moments in the mid-20th century. The first was the New Deal and the response to the New Deal, in particular, the fact that the court ultimately switched gears and was willing to accommodate the social programs that were passed in Congress, which shifted both the position of mainstream labor as well as the political elites around FDR to say that maybe we don't actually need to fundamentally transform the institutions. The second was the war, especially with Nazi Germany and the ways in which the lead up to the war created a kind of rediscovery of the Bill of Rights, and through the Bill of Rights, a valorization of the rights protecting elements seemingly embedded in the constitutional system that provided a kind of glow even over at that time, the broken institutional processes associated with it. And then especially the Cold War. So the combination of the politics of a McCarthyite right in the US and of the perceived threat from the Soviet Union in the context of global competition created a sort of shared position in the center among mainstream center-right and center-left figures around a particular narrative about the Constitution. The thought was that the threats to the country came from a kind of populist extremist politics that linked both communism and McCarthyite fascism, and that the real threats to the country were therefore the product of what you could call a tyranny of the majority. And if that was the case, then these institutions that were so deeply undemocratic that it seemed broken just 20 years earlier in the 30s were reimagined as actually ideal types. that rather than an extreme and destructive form of judicial review with virtually no meaningful external checks, judges serving for life, that extremism was read as a way of containing mass popular sentiment that was viewed as a threat. There are lots of problems with this account, the first of which is it's a fundamental misread of the processes over the course of the 20th century by which meaningful change took place. The achievements of the New Deal were not the product of insulated elites, let alone insulated judges, but of organized supermajorities of the working class. And indeed, you can say much the same about civil rights achievements. Rights achievements were entrenched through popular political action rather than by insulated courts. But nonetheless, what this ended up doing over time is it suppressed the idea that when we talk about the Constitution, what we should be talking about are the institutions. And indeed, increasingly, by the time we get to the 50s and 1960s, discussions of the Constitution become reduced to discussions almost exclusively of judicially managed debates and reforms. And then this has a massive impact on the scholarship. Rather than political science departments, history departments being the primary spaces that study the Constitution, it becomes law schools. And this is noteworthy because in the early 20th century, most law schools didn't even include constitutional study as a required course. That didn't actually emerge until the 1930s, and that emerged alongside administrative law with the Constitution somewhat of an afterthought. Indeed, for the first half of the 20th century, the most important law professors were not folks that focused on the Constitution at all. They're people that studied torts or property or contracts. Now what you see happen is the steady emergence of the constitutional scholar as the most well-known public face of the legal academy with close relationships to the courts. And through those close relationships to the courts, a sustained conversation between elites in the legal profession and judges that might have been their previous bosses when they were clerks over the terms of constitutional interpretation. And all of the big questions about institutional design removed comprehensively from the table. Instead, the discussion became one about, well, maybe the Constitution should be thought of as a living document, an outline that can be read into different values in ways that are consistent with a kind of inherent promise there always at the founding. And this reevaluation of the Constitution, of the framers, also interestingly ended up generating its own kind of resurgence of a right-wing alternative, which is, well, maybe the best way then to think about the Constitution, if it was really ideal from Madison and Hamilton, is to follow what they truly believed, the originalism that we're most familiar with. And it's in this context that you have a kind of originalist culture that's deeply venerative of the Constitution that emerges, such that by the 70s and 1980s, you have this strange feature by which the general political conversation is really about like the greatness of the framers and how their wisdom can be held onto, with conservatives arguing that, you know, simply enacting their original will get you the right outcome in every single circumstance. And even if, you know, originalism doesn't necessarily produce conservative outcomes in each individual case, a culture that's built on venerating 18th century slaveholding economic elite founders promotes a society that's deeply reverential, deferential to elites, and unwilling to ask the really hard questions about the present. So this is where I'll end. What does that mean for now? I think it means that we need to fundamentally transform our constitutional system. But like socialists, not only do we need a different theory of institutional design, we need to have an appropriate praxis for the moment. That means not focusing on silver bullets like a constitutional convention or a single amendment, but rather thinking in the way that radicals in the early 20th century thought, which was to see society as riven between conflicting interests of haves and have-nots, and to organize their actions around how can you implement revolutionary reforms that alter the existing balance of power, that make it harder for the existing social order to reproduce itself. And these reforms might be to the constitutional system. For us today, maybe it's, you know, multi-member districts or statehood for DC as small scale reforms, but it could also be a guaranteed job, guaranteed income, that they, and their elements across the institutional landscape, levers across the institutional landscape that transform the bargaining position of those most oppressed. And in this way, I think the best way to think about the moment is one in which we have to sort of combine a utopian horizon of profound transformation within, my view, a politics that looks to the present and sees, well, how can you actually disrupt the existing power relations such that those that have historically been oppressed actually have sovereign power according to the terms that the constitutional system has always promised but never achieved?
Thank you, Aziz. I'm sorry that we couldn't get your whole book in, but we did manage to get Charles Beard in the beginning, so you did sort of cover the span of American constitutionalism. I'm going to go next, and my talk is kind of a prelude to Camilla's, who I'll introduce before she talks. It's a story that I think transparently illustrates the naked use of a constitution for specific ends, or the instrumentalization of constitutionalism in a very, very illuminating way. Story begins in 1959. Fidel Castro comes into Havana, freaking out in America and the foreign policy established. After about two nervous years with the Bay of Pigs and the missile crisis, the US decides that it's in a competition for the hearts and minds of Latin Americans. So an organization is formed called the Alliance for Progress, Alianza para el Progreso. The motto, as Robert Kennedy said, is those who make peaceful revolution impossible make violent revolution inevitable. So it was going to offer a non-communist way to development. Now, this particular theory, by the way, was manifest over the whole world at the time, and particularly in Vietnam. Behind it was a man named W.W. Rostow, who wrote a book called The Stages of Economic Growth. And the idea was essentially to bring people to create a vigorous capitalist economy in the countryside. And the obstacle to development in this theory was a kind of feudal landowner class all over the world. So the idea was to eliminate them, give every individual farms or companies farms, and there'll be a good thriving capitalist agriculture, and the country can develop into a capitalist, a thriving capitalist country as it's destined to, according to the five stages of economic growth. The showcase for the Alliance for Progress was Chile. And in 1964, the CIA donated $4 million to the election campaign of Eduardo Frei, who became elected president from the recently formed Christian Democratic Party. And the centerpiece of the party's platform was agrarian reform. And it was going to enact this theory of development. Now, there was only one problem with this, and that is that the landowning class in Chile on these big, what would be called latifundia in other parts of the Hispanic world, were called fundos in Chile. There's a very funny line from a Bolaño novel where Bolaño's at a party and everybody says, oh, don't you have a fundo? As if everybody has a fundo. But anyway, this control of the fundos enabled them also to control the political life of the country. So the notion of their being reformed out of existence was something that created a violent response. When the agrarian reform law was passed, and remember, with the support and encouragement of the United States, the right's reaction was violent. There were spectacular cases of a murder of administrators from agricultural industry, from the agricultural ministry, who would go out to take over the acres on a fundo that were unused. You could basically expropriate anything above 80 acres. This essentially created a reaction in the countryside. There were white guards, armed bands of people. And one could say, in effect, that at this point, the right seceded from Chile in the way that the South was on the verge of succeeding. Notice that the violence doesn't arrive, as the right says, with the election of Allende in 1970. It starts before it as a response to the agrarian reform. when Salvador Allende is elected and the violence increases, the right's goal becomes not just to throw out Allende, but to make sure that neither a Salvador Allende nor an Eduardo Frei, a Christian Democrat, can ever be president of Chile again. They want a new constitution that will make these two elections impossible. This is not known to the Americans, who think when they support a coup, what they call track two of their goal, the violent overthrow of Allende, they will get an anti-communist like Eduardo Frei, who will support them in the UN and so forth. And whatever he chooses for his economic mode of government, whether it's a kind of a state-driven Keynesian, Nixon and Kissinger, who are geopoliticians above all, don't really care. There's no emphasis on neoliberalism here. There are Chicago boys, as we well know, who are in the economics department of the Universidad Católica. But the resistance to Allende, the grassroots resistance that develops, is led out of the law school of the Católica and inspired by a man named Jaime Guzman, who was fundamental in the creation and writing of the new constitution. So the goal from the beginning of the right, unknown to the US, is that Chile will be turned into a blank slate and a new frame of government will be written that will essentially put, as one person calls it, democracy in chains. So there is the coup, and instead of what the US was pushing for, which is essentially for the military to hold government for 2 months or 3 months, and then essentially turn it over to Eduardo Frei again. The military held it for 17 years and they created a constitution in 1980. In order to write that constitution, they received help not only spiritually from Hayek, but literally from a man named James Buchanan, who is a representative of public choice theory in America, which is a form of political theory economics, which essentially tries to turn everything over to rational choice or the market. And so he was there to essentially advise on the Constitution. His introduction to Constitution writing and politics, he appears on the political scene in Virginia after the Brown versus the Board of Education decision, where Virginia closes its public schools for a year in order not to implement the decision. But then Buchanan's advice to Virginia was to turn all those schools into private schools so they wouldn't have to comply with the decision. So the origin of charter schools comes out of the fertile brain of James Buchanan, who then goes down with his white supremacist ideas and his anti-democratic bent and advises Chile how to create this constitution, which is unveiled in 1980 and is called a protected democracy. I'd like to turn over the story of the fate of this particular constitution and the glorious news that we've heard in the last couple of days from Chile. Now, let me just say that Camila Vergara is at Columbia now, teaches at Columbia, and is the author of a book called Systemic Corruption. What's the subtitle, Camila?
Constitutional Ideas for an Anti-Oligarchic Republic.
Constitutional Ideas for an Anti-Oligarchic Republic, which is a reading of Machiavelli, Condorcet, Hannah Arendt, and is an also author.
Rosa Luxemburg.
Excuse me?
And Rosa Luxemburg.
Oh, Rosa Luxemburg. Yes. I should forget Rosa Luxemburg. May I be cursed. But what I would say is the chutzpah of the book, if I can say it, is that she doesn't just talk about the theory of the Constitution. she offers a sample constitution there, lays it all out on the line for people to pick apart or to adopt. And she's also consulting with some legislatures now on the Chilean constitution. So I turn it over to you to continue the story of Chile, Camila.
Thank you so much, Philip, for this invitation. Once again, this is my second time at Red May. I'm very excited. And I'm very excited about the process, the constituent process in Chile that is happening now, that can actually bring an opening and changing of the constitutional structure of representative democracy, not only in Chile, but maybe in the world, something to copy. So I just wanted to follow up on Philip's assessment of Chile and how neoliberalism was constitutionalized in Chile with this majority rule, minority rules and entrenchments. It was very interesting because we can think about neoliberalism only as policies that were implemented by the Washington Consensus, forced by the IMF in the Global South. But in Chile, it was a really a juridical problem, something that was attacked through, you know, the rules of the game, as you can think about the Constitution as the rules of the game. And as Aziz was saying, basically the same as in the U.S., the constitutional structure really unlevels the playing field, just tilts it in favor of the rich and already powerful. And in Chile, what happened was that basically the state was first deprived of all its economic activity. So everything was privatized. All basic services were privatized, from education to health to pensions. And then industries were created, private industries were created to basically subsidize. The state became to subsidize these private enterprises that took care of private interest and private services, basically. You were free to choose any plan of health that you wanted, right? And basically it was all in the market. And one of the features of this new constitution was the pension system, which today is being demolished little by little by forcing the government to accept withdrawals from your private pension account in order to pay for the cost of the pandemic. So the state today, and we see how the arch of, you know, the subsidiary state, as we call it, really comes all together in the sense that in the worst pandemic, we have savings because of our, you know, good numbers and economic growth, but the government is not willing to spend those savings on the people, and therefore has basically the only way of aid has been through the independent pension, your own money basically for retirement. And now at least 40% of the people who have withdrew from their accounts have nothing left in their accounts. So basically we are in a crisis right now that is pretty dire. So different from the US, in Chile, we haven't sacralized the constitution, because the constitution was made under dictatorship. So we are basically brought up in very different kind of hegemonic narratives. We don't mystify it. We know that it is, you know, the origin is a bad origin, is a dictatorial origin. And therefore, for me as a scholar, it was obvious that at some point this constitution needed to change, and not just being reformed. Our constitution has been reformed many dozen times, okay? And the spirit, as Carl Schmitt would have it, hasn't changed. It's the same constitution that has been kind of reformed around the edges. And this constitution was validated for the first time when we came back to democracy in 1990. That was the first time that the constitution was actually implemented. And actually, James Buchanan came both in 1980 and also in 1988 to Chile to advise on how to entrench minority rule. And of course, it was very kind of open and vulgar the way that it was entrenched, because we had designated senators for life. We had, you know, all the appointments on the Supreme Court were all kind of quotas from the right-wing coalition that was always in the minority and always having being overrepresented by the electoral system. So in a way, all these levers were created, designed in order to not allow for the majority to break through the oligarchic grip of, you know, the institutions. So basically popular demands from the beginning. Imagine a country that was in dictatorship for 17 years, it goes into democracy, and we all think that basically the nightmare is over. And the slogan of the Concertación, which was basically the party coalition center left that pushed for the coming back to democracy, the slogan said, La alegría ya viene. So the happiness is coming. And today, after 30 years of democracy that has basically created precarity and has fully entrenched the power of the powerful few of the seven families that basically rule the country in the back, you know, in the background, we are today saying, well, the happiness never came. Basically, we were promised all these things that democracy was supposed to bring us, but our basically votes never yielded any changes, structural changes to the system. So basically, all was seen as about economic growth and the trickle-down economics. This was the hegemony until, you know, October of 2019. Of course, we have had increasing popular movements starting from the mid-2000s, which started protesting against the system. So basically, the first protests were high school students during the first year, the first government of Michel Bachelet. The second socialist to actually be in president in Chile after the dictatorship. And the high school students rised up because they understood that the laws or the organic laws that basically are derivative from the constitution were prohibiting the structural changes that education needed. So basically education is municipal and is subsidized, and the public education are only kind of for the poor, are very kind of if you have a little bit more, you always try to buy your way out of, you know, public education because overcrowding and the same things that happened in the US, basically that public education has been underfunded and basically has been just left to its own devices in a way, and imposed some strict testing that is very nasty in terms of like the outcome for children. So they started protesting, the high school students, and that led to increasing protests, because at the beginning we were very scared of protesting because democracy was very, very fragile. We need to remember that Pinochet, in order at his exit pact to get out basically without being judged, was that he was going to be the commander in chief of the armed forces for the first 7 years of democracy. And then he would go immediately into being a senator for life with immunity, that he could not be judged. And we need to remember that he was captured in England due to a warrant from a Spanish judge. And then the Chilean government lobbied in order to bring him back to Chile to judge him. And at the end, he died in his house without being judged. So this is kind of like at least the metaphor of Chile, that things that are supposed to work, they didn't. And actually, they worked for the opposite outcomes. So one of the features of the system is that it has been insulating the representatives from the people. So very similar to the US, in which the system was thought of as a filter, as filtering the popular will, that the popular will was too savage in a way and needed to be tamed and passed through different levers in order to become basically wise. And at the end, the natural elite would govern. And this was basically the same idea in Chile, that you need to select your representatives and then leave them alone to do the governing. And people just need to mind their own business. So there's no mechanisms for recall elections or for popular initiatives or for pushing for changes through local government, because even local governments are not autonomous in the sense that they cannot take care of their own money. Basically, they cannot tax, and they cannot have autonomy on how they spend it. The only income that municipalities have is the licenses for driving and for, you know, cars, which is very little money, and they cannot really create change that the people demand. So at the local level, which is the closest that you have that the people experience the relationship with government in the municipality, then the municipality's hands are tied. So there's no kind of accountability, and therefore there's demobilization. conversation, okay? And this happened during 30 years in which neoliberalism was deepened. So famously, our first socialist president in democracy, Ricardo Lagos, was one of the most strongest supporters of private and public enterprises and basically privatizing roads, for example, instead of investing in trains in a 4,000 kilometer long country, he decided to bring a private investment and create superhighways that are basically run through cities and you need to pay. So there's an upper height in socioeconomic upper height in Chile, in which if you have the money, you have basically the highway. And if you don't, you are stuck in traffic for 2 hours and you are in an awful commute. And this kind of permeates all structures of life, from health to pensions to education, all the way through. We have a minimum wage that basically gives you, you are below the poverty line, very similar in the United States, the idea that you need one or two jobs to actually stay afloat. And it has created a very precarious, hollowed middle class. And all the growth has been on the back of private debt. So the average family pays 75% of their monthly income in debt, okay, to the banks. So this situation got us to this popular uprising in October 2019, in which the government decided to increase the metro fare by nothing, 30 pesos, which is, you know, very little money. But in accumulative terms, it was going against the income, the monthly income of, you know, the working class family. So again, the high school students rised up and they went into a massive civil disobedience campaign, jumping the turnstiles, and they basically interacted. They fought the government, and they jumped the turnstiles, and they created this basically this revolution. If we're going to see it in retrospect, basically this popular uprising by this kids that actually cannot even vote. They're not in voting age. They are the ones who push the government to a corner and force the government to allow for a plebiscite. We voted. 80% was approved, you know, the change. So now, after many changes of dates due to the pandemic, we are now, we have selected a convention. And the problems, of course, immediately arise when we have, you know, the popular demands coming from below, and you have the social change at the gates of government. Government preemptively basically allowed for this agreement, for opening up, you know, the process, but put its conditions. So the most important condition was that every article in the constitution needs to be approved by a two-third supermajority in this convention. So therefore, the right-wing coalition was, you know, betting in that they would take at least a third of the vote. Okay, and because historically Pinochet got 46% or 43-44% of the vote, of the yes vote, that he, when we came back to democracy, people voted for him to stay. So crazy. Chileans are very kind of like the strong hand. And the right-wing coalition has consistently been, you know, having between 30 and 40%, a little bit more overrepresented due to, you know, the system. But now they got below the quarter. So 24% of the seats in the convention. So they don't have the outright veto. However, we need to take into account that the ex-concertación, which are the kind of the neoliberal left, if it's, you know, something that we can even think about, that kind of like oxymoron, you know, compound. They are the biggest losers, because they were the biggest coalition, at least more than 40%, and they got 16%. So basically, these are the kind of the reactionary part of the coalition of the center left, and people are arguing that they will vote with the right wing coalition. So they will have the veto after all, but it will, you know, it's different to have like an outright veto, so that they don't have to even talk to anybody to just veto any of the socioeconomic rights that people demand, than to have to kind of like pact with the concertación in order to get that veto. The other very interesting thing that has happened is that there was a list called the List of the People, La Lista del Pueblo, which basically aggregated independents who wanted to run. And this list got 27 seats, which is 17%, which is a lot. And in all like the months long campaigning, the the media just gave them 2% as a kind of the probability, okay? So all of, again, if we can think about, you know, the Chilean crisis as the elites not seeing it and basically living in a la-la land of like the 1% and all the kind of growth and investment, that they didn't see the precariousness of the people, they didn't see, you know, the independence really coming in. So it's very interesting and very exciting that this is happening, because this is coupled, and with this I will finish, with the organizing that has started from the beginning in October, during the uprising in October 2019. What Philip was saying, that we basically, and I think we are going back to this idea of the 1920s, that we are in a way in a similar conjuncture today, that we need to go back to kind of that time to kind of get some insights in a way. I think we are in a moment in which, you know, we have fascist forces, you know, increasing also in Chile, anti-migrants, you know, very ethno-nationalist. And also you have popular spontaneous organization from below. Okay, so the moment the October uprising happened, people started meeting in local assemblies spontaneously. They started talking about what was wrong about themselves, and they started understanding that the problems were not individual, but actually collective, that it was the system. So immediately this kind of organization was crystallized into a demand for a new constitution, and constituent cabildos, as we're calling them, emerged everywhere. There was a study that systematized around 2,000 cabildos around the country, none of them with the ones that I've been in touch. So there's more. And of course, this doesn't appear in the news, right? There's no visibility, but it's happening and people are connecting. And then the pandemic, you know, forced people to veer from, you know, the constitutional issues to actual sustenance in a way. So the mutual aid flourished since it didn't, when it was pervasive in the 1980s after the crisis of the debt in Chile. Las ollas comunes, you know, these common pots just starting emerging again. And today there's many common pots that are run periodically in neighborhoods. So therefore politics and sustenance and maintenance and mutual aid work together. And now they're kind of inseparable, because people basically have lunch in the common pot, and then they discuss politics and they do it in the common square, you know, in the open square. So it's just a beautiful thing that is happening. And now this lista del pueblo, these people that are independents, that they don't have really an ideology or an agenda. There may be some single issue, you know, candidates for nationalizing water, which is private today, for example. They think that they are not experts, that they're not there to decide by themselves, that they wanna be connected to their territories. So now the first battle that's gonna be fought in the convention is the internal rules of conduct, you know, of how business is gonna be carried out. So part of the strategy, at least from my side, is to push for a binding, you know, engagement with the citizenry. You know, in a way that there is a mechanism to push for the representatives to go back to their districts and talk and tell them basically to the people what has been discussed, what has been their position, and also to gather all the inputs from the people, what they want, and basically represent that or be the spokespeople of their, you know, their districts with these demands in the convention. This would allow for the more radical and kind of grassroots leaders to actually have a backup, not just being elected and have an electoral authority, but actually have organized citizenry behind them pushing for radical change, and not just leave the business to the negotiation within, you know, closed doors and with a two-thirds supermajority that actually can block social change. So this is a very exciting time. My book that Philip mentioned, Systemic Corruption, I translated it and kind of abridged and published as a pamphlet a la Rosa Luxemburg of the 1920s. And it was, you know, the publisher allowed for it to be sold at cost. So it has circulated, and I put a guide for making your own counsel using current legislation. So using kind of the weapons that are there for our own advantage in order to change the world and to create a structure, an infrastructure for popular power that is clearly lacking. So one of the worst thing of our constitutional systems is that only the elite have power. the people have no power whatsoever, and the elites police themselves. And as Condorcet would say, this doctrine of the separation of powers just breeds this kind of complex system in which it enables basically a parallel government that is, you know, behind closed doors, what he calls the indirect despotism. Thank you.
Thank you, Camila. Yeah, I mean, in a way, it's a continuation of that que se vayan todos from the movement of the squares. You know, they don't represent us. You know, and what you say about the media is true in America or everywhere. The only thing they hear is the center left, of which they're a part of. Everything that's happening outside takes them by surprise. So I think we'll move on to Richard now. Richard is an independent researcher. He's an archivist for The Nation, has this wonderful book called Break It Up, Secession, Division, The Secret History of America's Imperfect Union, which chronicles the constant stresses and fissures from the beginning of the Republic to the end, and of course makes a nice reading alongside Aziz's Two Faces of Freedom, and I'm sure of his new book, makes one aware at how often we've been on a knife edge that we've walked off. So in terms of, I also want to mention that he has a new article on Thaddeus Stevens, the radical Republican, as an emblem of the road not taken. And if one follows Walter Benjamin's approach to history, which is one has to keep going back into the past and finding those moments that were never developed but could have, and taking that road instead of the one that was taken. It's the radical Republican road for America's unfinished reconstruction. Richard, where is that published in? You have to have your...
That was in the Baffler.
Oh, and the Baffler, it's a good choice. Yes. So I'll turn it over to you. You can tell us of the stakes of not getting it all together.
All right. Well, thank you, Philip. And thank you, everybody at Red May, for getting the panel together, and Camila and Aziz. I thoroughly enjoyed, as I'm sure everybody is, your presentations. You know, Aziz, I wrote an article for The Nation a few years ago arguing that the left should embrace the right's kind of growing movement for a constitutional convention. But I appreciated your urging us to think bigger, and not look for such a silver bullet. And Camila, I mean, the idea of holding a referendum, I'm sure most people on the call will agree, holding a referendum on the United States Constitution, you know, up or down, keep it or not, is a tantalizing prospect. I think I'm going to start with where I got the idea. You know, I feel completely unqualified with this, you know, illustrious panel as a simple hack on Grub Street. But, I had the idea, and it's interesting because Aziz talked about Charles Beard. I was an archivist, as Philip mentioned, for The Nation magazine in about 2012. I was an intern. I held on for dear life and managed to get this post as archivist to prepare for the magazine's 150th anniversary. It was founded by abolitionists, former abolitionists, in 1865. So the anniversary was in 2015. So we had a couple of years to prepare. And as part of the anniversary issue, one of the things we were having is having current writers and scholars comment on specific pieces from the archive and talking about how they worked and how they, you know, maybe didn't, talk about pieces from the archives and different meanings that we could glean from them. So I give myself the assignment of commenting on The Nation's review, and it was a conservative magazine at the time, review of Charles Beard's Economic Interpretation of the Constitution, published in 1913. And it was a very negative review. The writer of it was a guy named Simeon Strunsky, and he was very acerbic, you know, really witty, but you know, quite a reactionary fellow. And he was, you know, the veneration that we're all familiar with now, you know, which is that if you tear down the founders, where would that leave us? You know, basically an anarchy or whatever, something like that. But in order to write the review, I had to read Charles Beard, of course. So I was in the New York Public Library one day and I was reading Economic Interpretation. Nobody had ever told me about this before. You know, even at The Nation, I mean, people don't talk about the Constitution. You know, people on the right talk about the Constitution, whereas we kind of agree to play on this completely unfair playing field. And at least until the last couple of years, I think, didn't even really know that we were doing so. But anyway, so I'm reading Beard, and it's all very interesting. And certainly he's, you know, come in for a couple of critiques over the years about his precise use of numbers and whatnot, but the critique really stands. You know, the Constitution was a coup d'etat. Michael Klarman, of course, you know, recently published The Framers' Coup, which shows this in, you know, exhaustive, if not exhausting detail. That was a coup d'etat, basically, to prevent a second American Revolution from happening. But I was struck, and I actually had to leave the library, by reading Beard's analysis of James Madison's Federalist 10, which is, you know, one of the most, you know, commonly read or misread, you know, pieces in American history. And, you know, what Madison says is we need to adopt the Constitution. We need to make a more perfect union, because if you extend the sphere of politics, if you take in more people, you will be better able to keep a minority from lording it over a majority, you know, or excuse me, Aziz will correct me. Is it majority or minority that he's talking about?
Overbearing majority.
An overbearing majority, you know, a faction of certain citizens from being able to kind of control, you know, politics and get their way. And it seemed to Beard, and it seems to me, that when most people talk about this text, they assume that Madison is an impartial observer of American politics, that he could be talking about X group or Y group, but he actually explicitly says so. He wants to keep groups from you know, calling for an abolition of debts and for a redistribution of property, including, of course, slaves. So I had to leave the library, basically, and go for a walk around Midtown Manhattan, because it struck me that the problem here was not only the Constitution, but the Union itself. Because when you're talking about extend the sphere, you're talking about the Union. You're talking about making politics bigger, which I had always been taught, and certainly all of my colleagues at The Nation believed, and I think still do, despite my best efforts, that nationalism, that big government or something, is inherently a progressive good. And the realization that at least one time, at the key moment of the founding, that had not necessarily been the case, that consolidation, as the Anti-Federalists called it, had what we would now see as anti-progressive ends, which was to prevent movements for an abolition of debt and for redistribution of property. That was an alarming kind of realization to me, you know, and a deeply unsettling one. So I'm going for a walk down Sixth Avenue in Midtown, and this is late 2014, November, and there's just been the verdict passed down, I believe, in Ferguson, that they were not going to, you know, try the cop who had killed Michael Brown. So it's the first wave of the Black Lives Matter protests. And I see people walking down the street, and I'm walking next to them. And a woman has a sign in neon green. It says, "The system isn't broken, it's fixed." And, you know, she was, of course, talking about criminal justice and race in America, but it was also what Charles Beard was saying, you know, about the Constitution, and indeed perhaps about the Union. And so that's what kind of convinced me that the issues were not simply antiquarian and not really simply about the founding of the United States and about the Constitution as it was originally devised and instituted, but was, you know, it was a living problem, basically, that we were living under these systems that were fixed, that had been built to achieve the ends that by 2014, it was quite clear they were very visibly achieving. Which was to prevent movements for abolition of debt and redistribution of property. So I started to kind of read the news differently, read everything and see everything differently, and wondering whether the Union was really on our side. You know, I'd always been taught, I think, or kind of had been steeped in the tradition that Aziz is talking about of mid-century kind of valorization worship, really, of like two or three Supreme Court cases, and that being a stand-in for what we're supposed to think, not only about the Constitution, but about the Union itself. So anyway, that's kind of a long way of getting into it, but I wasn't yet ready, and I'm, you know, frankly, still not ready to just call for disunion or for secession, because there's too many complicating factors, too many questions, too many obvious ways in which people who I don't want to suffer would indeed suffer from a breakdown of America's union. So instead, I wanted to basically read through all of American history again and just kind of add it up for myself and see what it came to and look for all the moments really where people had had kind of similar thoughts to me. I'm interested in the slave owners and the Confederates and all the reactionary people who have wanted to leave America, and some still do, obviously. But I was more interested in the people who were doing it, you know, who had proposed it or considered it for noble reasons, you know, for what I would consider to be liberatory or emancipatory reasons. And that took me 5 years because nobody had done it before. You know, there's studies of the idea of secession and disunion in every era of American history, but nobody had actually just come along and connected them. So it was just one of these instances of writing the book so that I could read it, basically. I just have here a couple of bullet pointed moments to talk about. I mean, I think one is as I began with 1786, 1787, where there's this huge fear that there's going to be a second revolution. And as the historian Carl Becker said, this one would not be over home rule, that is winning independence from Britain, but over who would rule at home, who would have the power, who would have the money in the new republic. And the Constitution, you know, basically is as I said, a coup d'etat effort to prevent that from happening. It's also, you know, I'm trying to basically unite two different paradigms here. One is kind of a neo-progressivism of Charles Beard and his many, many successors who have pointed to the class conflict in the American founding. And another is called, you know, the Federalist paradigm or the Unionist paradigm of scholars like David C. Hendrickson and Peter Onuf, who point to the ways in which the Constitution is a peace pact, basically an agreement to keep the different states, different regions that had conflicting interests and ideas about what the country should be from going to war. And I basically think that it was both. So that's kind of, you know, one thing. And then, you know, talking about a plebiscite in Chile, people don't ever think or much less talk about how significant it is that our constitution was put to a vote precisely once, you know, 250 years ago, almost. It was, as far as I understand, the elections were relatively democratic for the time. More people could participate in elections to the state ratification conventions than could vote in most state elections at the time. But it was still an extremely small slice of the population. Of course, women could not vote. Black people could not vote. You know, I think many poor people could not vote. And in other ways, the ratification struggle was, you know, suffused with violence and fraud. And it barely crossed the finish line, even with the scales so unevenly weighted as they were. And that's just, to me, that's absolutely galling and completely bizarre that we're stuck under this system that was put to a vote once and in really quite fraudulent ways. And I think that we should talk more about that. The other kind of chapter that I just want to mention, and, you know, maybe some people are familiar with this. I wasn't really, but the abolitionists before the Civil War who were in favor of disunion and even of Northern secession, not merely to protest slavery, that is, as many historians kind of criticize them for, to keep their own consciences clean, that they weren't sharing in the guilt of slavery, but they actually had a practical program for how disunion would erode slavery's guarantees, its foundation, you know, massively bring down the price of slaves and ultimately lead to the system's demise. We never had a chance to see this in practice, and a lot of historians take that as evidence that it would never have worked. I'm not so sure. And in any case, I find the example of people saying, no, this problem goes to the very root. Slavery can survive or the union can survive, but not both, I find to be completely inspiring and perhaps even suggestive of the proper attitude to take today. Again, a question mark at the end of that, not an exclamation point. And then finally, you know, Philip mentioned my recent piece about Thaddeus Stevens, which is a review of a wonderful new biography. I'll send the link into the YouTube thing by Bruce Levine, a great historian of the Civil War era, of Thaddeus Stevens, this guy who, you know, again, like I attended a fairly good public school. I went to college in Canada, studied philosophy, not history, but I didn't really know Thaddeus Stevens. I'm quite embarrassed to say, until the Lincoln movie of 2012, in which he was played by Tommy Lee Jones, I thought quite well. But still, that movie, as I write in the piece, depicts Thaddeus Stevens as somebody who's kind of too right for his own good, or too left perhaps, but too righteous for his own good, and somebody who got in the way of what Lincoln was really trying to do. And Lincoln is obviously the main hero of that movie, and indeed of American history. But Thaddeus Stevens is this guy who I've just been absolutely fascinated by for you know, almost 10 years now, and just leapt at the opportunity to review this new book, especially after the January 6th assault on the Capitol, or insurrection, I think is not an unfair term. I think that he's the person, and that time period is what we have to look to now. As Philip said, the great kind of wrong turn of American history, the closest we ever came to establishing a truly multiracial democracy. And also his ideas about what to do with a white supremacist insurrection, you know, which is to tear out the causes at the very root, which is precisely the opposite of what we're doing today. To bring it all kind of full circle, you know, one thing I struggled with in the book and in writing this review and all the time is, why do I like Thaddeus Stevens, who fought so hard to save the Union, if I'm at least disunion curious, you know, or secession curious? Because his great motivating kind of crusade, obviously during the Civil War, was to save the Union. But I think the answer is that even for somebody like Thaddeus Stevens, and I would argue, though it's a little less relevant to this talk, Abraham Lincoln, I think saw saving the Union as a means to an end. And that end being basically what's in the Declaration, you know, liberty, equality, and the pursuit of happiness, which I happen to think is a fairly, you know, proto-Marxist term. And it seems to me that what we see from Thaddeus Stevens after the Civil War, during Reconstruction, of course, we don't know what Lincoln would have done, is somebody who's trying to make all the sacrifice and all the bloodshed actually count for something, which is to say, actually make the Union count for something, that we shouldn't be for holding the country together simply for its own sake, but so we can do X, Y, or Z, which is preserve human equality and liberty. And Stevens never said this, but I think I'm prepared to. If we're not going to do that, if we're not going to undertake the constitutional revisionism that both Camila and Aziz are talking about and that we so sorely need, I do think that secession should be on the table, basically, or some kind of, if not disunion, then some kind of devolution to you know, the kind of local assembly that Camila talks about in her book. And I simply think, and as Aziz, you know, talks about, I think that it's a mistake to continue this lazy, reactionary veneration of the Constitution and indeed of the Union, and that we should, you know, declare independence basically from that kind of paradigm, and consider, is the Union serving the ends for which we want or not? I'll leave it there for now.
Thanks a lot, Richard. Thanks, everybody. You've opened up a whole lot of roads that one can potentially follow. I have a few questions to lay out. One thing particularly is, I think everybody here would agree that the left, maybe worldwide rather than just America, has an inadequate imaginary around the possibilities of institutions, or the struggle within and around and for institutions. The institutional road or something in the 60s or 70s was the wimpy alternative to the armed struggle or whatever. It seemed to imply the notion that one simply runs according to the current laws and accepts them in every way at all. The phrase that's starting to appear in a lot of left journals is revolutionary reforms, without particular specification as to what that actually would be. But I think, Camila, you sort of anticipate that when you say that within the convention, there's going to be an intensification of the class struggle over every particular inch that one tries to gain and open up a democratic space. So it seems to me that if the struggle within institutions is the class struggle, that is to say, how do you see, for example, the institutional struggle as being a way of destroying or hollowing out rotten institutions and finding ways to replace them with ones that are better, that open the way for further reforms, that don't just simply stop by providing some sort of halfway house or something inadequate. I mean, I think everybody here feels that there is a road to follow within the institutions, a right one and perhaps a wrong one, but that we have to be clear about why we're being involved with institutions rather than thinking that they can actually deliver what they claim to deliver. How would you articulate your feelings around that notion of what institutions can deliver? Yeah.
Yeah, I would say that the struggle cannot be within institutions as we have them. It's for institutions, okay? And I would follow here Niccolo Machiavelli in his understanding of constitutional structures as a mosaic. Okay, the idea that we can, and this goes against kind of the radical democratic, you know, theory in which the idea of the constituent power is to basically create anything from nothing in a way. So kind of this ex nihilo creation of and recreation and kind of leveling to the ground all the rotten institutions. For Machiavelli, we cannot spend our political capital destroying what we have because the elites and everybody that benefits from those institutions will fight for them. What we need is to include new institutions, but not new institutions that are kind of appointed or, you know, semi-autonomous. They have to be dependent on the people. And the idea is that you bring a new actor, you institutionalize a new actor, you bring a new actor into the system, and therefore you change the dynamic of the system. So the idea of creating an infrastructure, an institution for the people as a council system that actually can work and it's not that difficult to do in a way. It is very difficult within our constitutional mindset in which we have the executive, the legislative, the judiciary, you know, and we forget that all these powers were just created out of thin air. Basically, they were written down and then when materialized. The same we can do with a popular actor. And I think in Chile, the difference here is that convention, the constituent convention, is a new organ. It's an extraordinary organ. So therefore, the people have more leverage in which to how to shape how the organ is going to work. So the struggle is twofold in Chile, at least. One is the streets. And they're not, you know, in Chile, there are already more than 400 people that have lost one eye. You know, the repression is terrible. There's five reports of human rights violations against Chile. So it is pretty dangerous. However, the people that have been mobilizing and the different sectors are pushing for more mobilization and for kind of like surrounding the convention in terms of like just with the pitchforks kind of thing. However, we know that we cannot really control violence, that violence erupts and the majority of violence comes from either, you know, right-wing extremists that are in the mobilization or by infiltration of, you know, police. We have been several cases already that people know that were basically some arson cases that actually were started by police. So it's very difficult and very dangerous to go that route because basically you can end up with a convention in a bunker and completely detached from the citizenry. So what I'm pushing for and what is actually happening on the ground is that people are getting into these deliberative organs that have power in themselves in a way. There is a popular legitimacy that needs to be built and institutionalized in order to be recognized. So we can build this new institution and put it into this new framework in order to change the way democracy works and basically migrate from an oligarchic democracy, a democracy that works for the few, into a plebeian democracy in which a democracy works for the many, in which the many have the final say and not elite institutions like the Supreme Court.
Aziz, do you have a...
Yeah, so, you know, I think the first thing that I would say is that I do think we're living again in a special moment in American history, which is in my lifetime, this is the period where left ideas are most ascendant. I can't remember any other moment in my own living memory where I feel like the actual arguments, and here not just of liberals, but of you know, self-consciously socialist left, are actually shaping significant elements of the popular conversation, frankly, from domestic economic policy to how to think about endless wars and, you know, events in Palestine. But what's striking about it is the extent to which this left ascendance, which is an intellectual cultural ascendance that's shaped by numbers that you can bring to the street, so spontaneous political activity, has not and is not yet translating into actual institutional control. And we can think of that in a couple different ways. Like, we can think of that just in terms of, you know, the decision-making apparatus and leaders in the Democratic Party. We can think about that in terms of what have been the classic social bases of left power, for example, the labor movement and unions, and both the strength of unions as well as like the continuing leadership of like the traditional wing of the labor movement. And so I think that that's basically the problem of the present that needs to be confronted. And I think it needs to be confronted with a recognition of both the external pressures that generated this and the internal weaknesses within the left. So taking seriously both elements of it, that the fact that the left in the US was reduced essentially to an extra institutional and spontaneous force, you know, basically by the time we get to the 60s and 70s, is not just happenstance. It was the conscious product of like the purging activities of the Cold War state, where essentially if you were somebody with left politics, you were purged from the various political parties, you faced extreme forms of state violence and crackdown, especially if you're African-American, where you, you know, the leadership of, you know, many of the different wings of the of Black politics found themselves arrested, killed, or forced into exile. So one reason why the left essentially, you know, is reduced to extra institutional voice is because they were removed from institutional spaces. And then the second is, you know, a genuine conservative political turn that the country and especially, you know, white politics experienced in the mid 20th century, that went hand in hand with the decline of the labor movement as an insurgent force in American life. And it was that conservative turn that fed a lot of the conventional wisdom that shaped the modern Democratic Party, that you have to, you know, pledge allegiance to Constitution and country and talk about the greatness of American exceptionalism and the free market and all of these things just to be viewed as having any kind of national public credibility. And so we're in a moment where I think much of that conventional wisdom has shifted, but there's still a basic question about how do you actually build something like a genuine popular majority for the left in a country in which, for a variety of different reasons, the left has been, you know, systematically contained. And I think what that requires in the present is, you know, really thinking seriously about how is it that left forces can claim control over existing institutions, and then also what to do once you're in that position, how to both claim power and then think really creatively about transforming those institutions. And it's based, in my view, on a recognition that at the end of the day, you know, left change is going to require engaging with the state. It's going to require civil service that's a left civil service. It's going to require knowing how to operate within the context of a complex technocratic modern society. It's going to require having the capacity, for example, even if you think something like the National Security Agency should be eliminated, like how do you actually go about doing that practically? That's in fact a civil service question that requires what amounts to, you know, left-wing cadre that can operate in the context of these institutions. And, you know, that's that strikes me as the challenge of the present. And it's not an easy one. It's significantly harder, frankly, than in the 30s and 40s, where you can't count on the left in the context of American politics to be able to just to develop through a base like the labor movement, super majorities that can overcome the various veto points of the political system. But it has to be, it's a, you know, it's the popular struggle of our time that has to be waged.
I'm going to go to Camila in a second, but I want to follow up this notion of institutions for a second suggest that how do we deal with the fact that the problem goes beyond institutional design when a lot of the extreme changes in the locus of power occur without institutional change, where the 14th Amendment, which is passed for one thing, is absolutely distorted. So it's no longer about the freedmen, but it's about corporate personhood, which even Walter Lippmann, when he was starting the neoliberal colloquium, said, you know, the judges' decisions in the 19th century have been ridiculous, which is why liberalism is such a in such low esteem in the 1930s, because instead of going with the popular will, they've retreated behind institutions and distorted their purpose. You know, they and you can even see something like the filibuster, where the country has been changed without an institutional change from a majority country to a supermajority country. So that sort of suggests, aren't we looking at a Poulantzas notion where power in a state is not a triangle and a hierarchy with positions that are located, designated notches, but it's a field in which the antagonist can retreat behind other elements of the field and make them central in the way that they weren't or weren't designed to be. You can always sort of, the phrase from the situationists is détourner things. You can change the destination of the object and make it serve other purposes. How do you deal with that sort of notion where the oligarchy retreats behind some aspect of institution and exalts that institution into a center of power?
So this is basically what I call systemic corruption, the idea that the rules of the game and the institutions are basically supposed to work in one way, in a way, but they work in another, right? They work in favor of the few, right? So this is something that is a process of decay, if you will, of the elites having too much power and these institutions being porous to their power and therefore making them, allowing them to wield the power of the institution for their own benefit. I think that is a process that we cannot really counter without organized popular power from outside institutions, at least as we conceive them. But I wanted to talk about a little bit about Aziz as insights were triggered me in the sense that there is an aversion, I think, of the left to institutions and also to law that we have been talking, right? The idea that the majority of people in the left don't care about the law, don't care about institutions. Why? Because institutions are very problematic. If we come from a more anarchist a background, in the sense that we believe that there are structures and dominations that are happening within organizations, and therefore there's an aversion to these organizations, then you don't want to really build institutions because you believe that building institutions will allow for more oligarchization, will inevitably become corrupt. So therefore it stays in the extra legal, in a way, in the extra institutional. And I think from the left, then the real challenge now is to think about how to really break through that law of the oligarchization of organization, this law by Michels, basically, of the iron law of oligarchy. How can really we build institutions that do not reproduce the same logic of representation, of exclusion, of hierarchy, and reproduce other logics of horizontalism, of anti-discrimination, of inclusion, and how they can be basically maintained through time? Because if these institutions are going to be governed by a leadership within, they will become eventually oligarchized. The gap between the grassroots and the leadership always begins to grow immediately. So therefore, I think that is a challenge. And I think the left has been very slow in taking up that line. And now in Chile is basically up for grabs. And we are trying to scrambling basically on what rules and how this institution should be designed in a way. And this is, I think, the great challenge and the great opportunity for left politics.
So Richard might want to jump in, but I think this connects to Camila's point in your question, which is, so to me, like the issue about like the problem with silver bullets is that there is this sense, and it's not just, you know, something that you see on the left, you see it across the political spectrum, which is if you get the right institutional device or the right interpretation or pass the right bill, then you'll that way you'll end up with the political results that you want. So let's say, for example, you don't like the focus on corporate personhood and what the court's been doing, Citizens United. So have a constitutional amendment that says that, you know, corporations don't have legal personhood status. And my view is that while any one of these adjustments or changes, you know, could produce positive outcomes, the problem is that in order to be able to actually understand what the likely effects will be, you have to have an analysis of power. And to me, this is like the great contribution of socialist constitutional theory and politics in the US in the early 20th century, which was don't focus as much on like institutional devices or particular modes of interpretation. Develop an analysis of like what the society looks like and the forms of conflict, struggle, and inequality that mark that society. If you recognize that the society has those that enjoy power, those that are oppressed, then necessarily what that means is that whatever the kind of the organization of the institutions and the forms of interpretation, they're going to end up being manipulated by those that effectively already enjoy sovereign power and have the benefits of how bargaining arrangements are set up. And so the goal basically is to treat interpretation of text, laws that you pass, institutional reforms to the Constitution or in other spaces as basically instrumental. Like their purpose is to ensure that those that are historically oppressed actually have power, can serve as something like, you know, a government behind the government, a standing and continuous source of political energy and activity that can intervene to transform existing relations. And so, you know, I think I have a theory, an abstract theory of what, you know, I would imagine to be a more democratic vision of the American constitutional order. But I think what's actually more important than that abstracted theory, even though that could influence some of my own choices, is to have an analysis of, well, how is power operating within the society and how do you actually disrupt that? That has to be the starting point in my opinion.
Richard, do you have something to add to that?
No, not quite. I'm just thinking that what you say, Aziz, about our thoughts about laws and institutions and the Constitution should be instrumental is basically what I'm saying about the union also, is that it's a means to an end. And that if we valorize any person, any movement, any party, any law, any amendment, or any federal arrangement as an end in itself, then we're missing the larger picture. So I think that I completely agree with that. Otherwise, enjoying the show.
There's a tendency to divide tactics into violence or persuasion as the two options that are on offer for the left. One thing that never comes up as an intermediate carrot, or rarely, is an intermediate tactic called force, I would say. And as an example of that, I would suggest Mitch McConnell, who doesn't try to persuade people on the other side of the aisle what he wants to do. He literally assembles the votes and pushes through anything. Doesn't use AR-15s to do it and so forth. There's this whole range of intermediate activity that one can call force and assembling forces that one can apply to institutions, to antagonists, that seems to be absent from the left vocabulary, at least to the extent that it should be present as a tactic. Do you agree with that, or do you see it? Do you think there's anything there in that thought that I can't articulate?
Yeah, so I feel like we just lost Richard, but I totally agree. I mean, I think the way that I describe it, and this just comes out of, you know, the conversations I've been having, is that, so, you know, Corey Robin has this wonderful pithy title to a piece that he wrote that's, democracy is norm erosion. I think it's democracy is norm erosion or democracy is norm breaking. And I think that's another way of thinking about it, which is the center left and left liberals in part because of the kind of Cold War fixation with the Constitution and reverence and devotion to the founders, have been really obsessed with the idea that norms, political norms, are in and of themselves good. And part of the problem in American politics is that many of the norms that we associate with the existing political system and also with the existing economic system, they might sustain a kind of calm, but it's a calm that imposes profound forms of social suffering and subordination. And that all of the moments, this is in a way directly connected to the work that Richard is doing. Like, if you just think about all of the great moments of democratic transformation in American life, they have been marked either by outright violence, civil war, or by a commitment to norm breaking on behalf of democracy because of the fact that democracy and norms have themselves been in tension. And that's the thing that I think, you know, basically the left needs to embrace. It's another way of describing the socialist praxis that I was articulating, which is thinking of the society as marked by profound struggle. And so having a realist assessment of what are the best ways of waging such struggle. My own view is that one of the lessons really of the mid 20th century in the 60s is a kind of romantic valorization of violence and revolutionary change was both an ethical and a political dead end. But that doesn't mean that the only option you have is to accept rigged rules of the game, that you can have a politics that's ultimately gradualist, but that is still revolutionary because it puts struggle at the center.
Yeah, I would say the great moment in Seattle politics was when everybody sat down and prevented the delegates from going into the WTO building. And look what that did for 3 or 4 days. It sparked off a whole movement. I mean, I have a question for Camila and to bring Aziz into this and hope Richard gets back on the conversation. Camila, you have an intriguing idea as to how to deal with kind of sclerotic institutions that are very difficult to reform from within, the executive, the judiciary, and the legislature. You want to create a fourth branch of government called the plebeian branch of government, modeling the idea on the Roman tribunate, but also in a way sounding to me like you're institutionalizing dual power in a very clever and productive way, if one can pull it off. And I should say that whatever problems it has, everything else has a problem too. So it's not that it isn't worth discussing. Could you describe how you see that particular notion of what powers it would have and how it would work? And then maybe Aziz, you could respond. I know you blurbed Camila's book, and so you know very well the proposal. I'd like to hear your reaction to it too. And Richard.
Well, thank you. So this plebeian branch is basically a counterpower, and is based on not only the Roman experience in politics, the Republic as it actually the power was wielded by plebeians, but also in the French Revolution. Because we need to understand that when we had, you know, representative democracy and became hegemonic, it's because the United States kind of won the battle, and in the sense of, you know, establishing a framework that would endure. And the French were not able. And actually, what happened in France with the Marquis of Condorcet, who I admire very much, even if we cannot call him a leftist, he was basically the most pro-democracy thinker of his time. For him, he was elite, he was a noble. For him, a government that would only have, you know, elected officials would be a government that will corrupt immediately and it will not work. For him, it's just, you know, the doctrine of separation of powers doesn't work. So he created and he basically put it in the constitutional draft, a system in which primary assemblies would have actual legal power to initiate legislation, So initiate a mandate to produce legislation in Congress to veto any law or policy and to impeach, and also to initiate a constituent process. And I think what we have been talking here, and I think what also Aziz and all this kind of like revolutionary politics point to is the duality between constituted power and constituent power, right? The power that is this foundational power that is inherently creative and has no limits in the world that exists in a way that could go beyond the constitutional box that we have created for ourselves. So this counterpower needs, you know, to have a power over government, cannot be just declaratory, which happened during the French Revolution, that basically the Jacobins took over because they didn't want to give, you know, power to the provinces, which were more conservative. So basically they just kept the system of primary assemblies, but got all the teeth out, basically didn't have all the provisions to control government. For example, one of them was if this system of primary assemblies would veto a law that was seen as corrupt and basically bad from Congress, the result would be that every politician that voted for that law would be dismissed, because either they are corrupt or they have no common sense. They have lost the trust of the people. So you have enforcement mechanisms. So it's not about having only a branch, it's also how you connect that branch to the other branches of government. So going to the Roman Republic and not just kind of like romanticizing assembly systems, you need a tribune, you need an office that is a delegate that would fight for what it is decided in the assemblies. The same as in Rome, the plebeians had their own assembly, that was a class-based assembly, and they had their own exclusive representatives who were not basically going to legislate on their own accord. They were going to push for what was decided in the plebeian assembly. So they were going to be the spokespeople and the kind of like the protectors of, you know, the popular will vis-a-vis the Senate, which was the representative government and the magistrates. So I think that is a solution, a permanent solution to our crisis of democracy, is this systemic corruption in which the rules of the game are used and abused by the powerful few to benefit themselves and to keep benefiting themselves systematically. We need to think about the Constitution not in the same way that we have been thinking about it, as a closed system. We should think about it in more creative terms, instead of like the idea of including more players in the system, of revisiting. The idea, just for me, I'm not a millennial, I'm too old to be a millennial, but the idea that how can we conceive ourselves within this constitution, as Richard said, that we only voted once in the 18th century? Why is that generation of founding the only people that is going to found and the only ones that are going to decide? Why is not every generation, as Thomas Jefferson would have it, as Condorcet would have it, they would need to basically decide on their own rules of the games, revisit the rules of the game? And it's not reinventing the wheel, but basically assessing and updating the system. If we're going to think about the Constitution as, you know, software or the operating system of a computer, we really need to update periodically. So instead of like waiting out and having all this kind of revolutionary energy every 40 years when it kind of bursts, we would need to think about ways of channeling this constituent power, this foundational power, in order to kind of integrate it into the system, in order to have an orderly revolutionary reform every once in a while.
I want to go to Aziz, but also mention that some paths we're not going to go down but could is relating this to the notion of the Soviets, councils, and so forth, and the argument that's always gone on between the centralization of power and the keeping of councils in various revolutions and so forth, or even the notion of destituent power, neither vertical nor horizontal, which is another we've had a whole events about, and would take a long time to discuss. But I want to follow down this approach. And I have a few more questions on it. So I'll start with Aziz to just respond to what Camila said.
Yeah, I mean, so I think the thing that I would say is that, so I think this is a really important recovery, and it's, you know, incredibly creative. And to me, the thing that's most significant for thinking, for example, concretely about American politics is The way in which this emphasis on counterpower highlights a profound problem with representative government in general and American presidentialism in particular, which is the ease with which a small political class can essentially substitute their own interests for the interests of the society at large in ways that highlight the profound conflict basically between the few and the many, to use sort of like the ancient language. And so then the question is, how do you actually create a political system that makes it very, very difficult for this substitution to take place? So you don't have a president in the context of a dysfunctional legislature that accumulates power through the national security state and then operates in a discretionary manner, either at the border or overseas, for instance, or replaces the lawmaking function of the legislature through the lawmaking function of the executive, or the legislative branch itself, which operates in a way that's like thoroughly disconnected from the interests that it's supposed to represent. And, you know, highlighting that question then allows us to think about, well, what would be mechanisms for generating such, such counterpower? You know, I would say we can think of it in terms of, you know, constructing new constitutional orders that would have things like a fourth branch, so formalizing it, or even frankly, like the Soviet workers' councils. Or we can think of it like, to me, a constitutional reform would be to have default unionization, you know, really significant rights that entrench people within unions, and then unions are itself a kind of institution that can serve as an institution outside of government that can be linked in various ways to political movements, that can be tied, for example, to having a much more simplified amendment process. So you have a mechanism to routinely engage in acts of constituent power. To me, the question is, you need something that's connected. What Camila said, which is a systemic mechanism to alter the rules of the game so that you can continuously transform the nature of the existing arrangements. But then second, you actually have to strengthen the social bases of the left. So you can't have that, but at the same time, basically have the existing distribution of power where the right controls more or less like the terms of a lot of these conflicts. So then you also have to have reforms that facilitate and strengthen institutions that are the equivalents of the, you know, those forms of like popular assembly or popularly organized authority that I was calling like the government behind the government. And, you know, we can think of lots of different creative ways to do it, but that combined relationship, I think, is what Camila is getting at with her work. And it highlights this basic problem of what happens when elites are essentially able to substitute their own interests for those of the society at large.
We'll get back to that. And I want to hand it to Richard in a second, but I want to say that I think Camille has hit the bedrock of what would be needed to make that branch work. And that's the death penalty, the plebeian death penalty. I want to riff on that a little after Richard contributes.
Sure, yeah. You know, there's a great essay by the critic George Shalaba, I think it's called Plutocratic Vistas, from about 10 years ago, in which he points out that in every revolution, there is some body, some small Soviet style body that as he says is able to constantly kind of alter the de jure, the kind of real power arrangements and what is considered legitimate exercise of power. You know, he talks about the committees of correspondence during the American Revolution, which in 1774, when the First Continental Congress instituted the boycott of all trade with Britain, took it on themselves to enforce this at street level. And what that often looked like was violence and, you know, tarring and feathering, but it was a truly revolutionary kind of usurpation of legitimate power. And in a somewhat different but also related way, the vigilance committees that the abolitionists used in the antebellum era to spirit fugitives away from slavery had an oddly similar kind of organizational structure to them, of these people forming what I sometimes think of as citizens' unions or constituent assemblies, perhaps in a different way. That's, you know, I basically had a question though for Aziz and Camila. Do either of you suspect, as I do, that this might not even be possible in the United States at our scale? you know, going on 400 million people, you know, in the next couple of decades. Is it possible that this is, you know, is it possible this is not possible, basically? I'm kind of a pessimist, you know, of both the intellect and the will. And I just wonder whether whether this is, you know, something like this could ever really happen in the United States as a whole, 50 or 51, 52 states, whatever it is, rather than would we need to grab onto some kind of smaller part of the territory in order to institute such, you know, sweeping fundamental changes?
I think in terms of the council system, of course, implementing it in a country as big as this one on a national scale, it would be kind of a tremendous effort, okay? However, because the council system is local, the idea that you are neighborhood assemblies and the municipalities and the local governments already have meeting spaces, okay, where people go, they have senior citizens, community centers, you know, there's many places where people can meet and actually deliberate. What you need are the procedures. And today we have the technology to do it. So basically we can communicate, because I didn't respond to Philip's question very well in terms of how would it work. So how would it work? People would get together in their local council. They would decide on a motion. They will simplify it to, you know, a yes or no kind of question, and they will vote on it after, you know, deliberating back and forth, right? And then that would pass to the assemblies that are territorially adjacent, and they would vote for it. So basically you can aggregate. So it would be a system that you doesn't need too much change in terms of how it would operate. The real difficulty, I would say, is to put the representative government under control of that council system, okay? Because the elites would never yield power. So the idea that they will give power, this is, I have talked to plenty of politicians and they were all, oh, this is fantastic, democratic. But then when they come to the pledge of, okay, if you get elected and you are as a mayor, for example, are you going to implement this system? Oh yes, fantastic. But are you going to obey the popular will when it emerges from this system? Well, you know, I think that it's inputs, there's voice, but I don't want to be constrained by the popular will. I want to do my own platform. And this is the problem with also the vanguard. Even the people that are more democratic, it's very difficult to convince them to yield power to the people in this manner. That being said, I would say that it's much more easier to do it in a country like Chile. Which is very small and actually has these assemblies already happening, are existing, right? So I think revolutionary politics need to build from what exists. And in the US, this movement doesn't exist still yet. You know, there are very local experiments, but the beauty of this system is that it could be implemented at the local level at one municipality, one city. And if it works there, it's the same as the UBI, you know, the universal basic income that is being tested in very small environments. You can do the same with local government in a way. You can do the same and if it works somewhere, maybe people will get more in tune with it. Of course, we need some incentives, because one of the problems of representative politics is that at least the 40% that is more deprived in the countries do not vote, do not participate in politics. So you don't want the system to be exclusive also of them, right? That you want them to participate. You want the people themselves to participate. So you need incentives. You need to pay them. That would be ideal, to pay them, you know, a salary to go and deliberate, to have childcare, to have, you know, food available. That is kind of a civic party, and it's not something that is costly, like going to vote and has no kind of benefit, immediate benefit, just to standing in line, actually has to have a routine, and we have to kind of create it from the ground up. And that could be created without the legal power over government, could kind of, you know, flourish and then take over. That would say that it's first de facto, the same as in history. Popular power has never been instituted from the top down, has always been gained through struggle and violence and force. So therefore, today is not different. We cannot wait for a politician to kind of illuminate us and bring us this kind of new system. It has to be built from the ground up.
Aziz, do you have a...
Yeah, I mean, I think that this is... So I feel like Richard's book really gets to the heart of some profoundly existential questions about the future of the US. And it strikes me that this bigness question has two different component parts that makes transformative change especially hard in the US. So the first thing is the extent to which the union and the scale of the union is bound up, you know, from the 18th century to the present with the story of American empire. That's something that we haven't discussed yet. In other words, that there is a clearly powerful driving narrative of American growth, expansionism, and, you know, frankly, like near continuous global footprint tied to an account of primacy that is closely associated with the scale of the project. A lot of what I Americans have traditionally venerated when they're venerating the union and the size of the union and its spread is effectively an account of imperial power and imperial largesse. And that's a problem because we don't really have good historical examples of empires willfully choosing to abandon their own imperial authority. And a lot of like the nationalist politics in the US is bound up with expansionisms of various kinds. So that's like one problem. And then there's a second, which is the version of political organization that holds the union together is this, you know, the system of federalism that's built around the states that devolves a great deal of power, not to the local level and to actual local constituents, but to this unit that maybe it made sense in the late 18th century, but now has been pretty thoroughly captured by a set of economic and racial elites in ways that make it very, very difficult to have, you know, organized national policies. And so you have essentially the problems of bigness in the US that one can associate in a way with the politics of empire, without the benefits of bigness, which is the capacity to actually pursue social change at an appropriate scale because of how federalism and the state system fractures political decision-making. And we're essentially trapped in between these two realities. And it's been very, very difficult to have frank conversations about it because of, you know, all of the narratives about national exceptionalism. But even if we wanted to have frank conversations, like as, you know, as many people did in the context of the pandemic, like we have a political system that seemed like it was impossible to actually produce fairly straightforward solutions to a massive health catastrophe because of how broken the national institutional process was. It's not clear if those problems can be overcome. I mean, I don't honestly have a good solution. I think that the solution at present is to see if you can actually build something like national majorities that maybe aren't equivalent to what you saw during the 30s with the New Deal, but approximate those and then use those national majorities to essentially fight both sides of the problem, which is to confront the ethical and material excesses and problems generated by the imperial dimension, and then to transform the institution so that you can actually have effective governance mechanisms. But, you know, if I was being totally frank, I don't know if that's a solution will be found. But, you know, that's essentially the problem that we're confronted by, and these seem to be the options at present.
I think we're going to extend this a little because this is such a good discussion. Run 10 minutes over, whoever can stay along. I wanted to get to Camila's social vengeance function because that to me is fascinating. I think it gets down to the root of one of the problems, which is essentially for people above a certain level, there is no rule of law. You do it, you lawyer up, you sign a non-disclosure agreement, you find out what the law is, and then you find a way around it. The odds that anybody involved in the insurrection at a high level, spewing forth the inspiration from it, who potentially in another polity could essentially be charged with treason and condemned to death are zero. And that suggests that one of the the policies of the essential policy to have a social vengeance problem is the fact that you have to really believe that there might be consequences that are ultimate if you do something. The French army borrowed from the Romans to deal with the mutinies on the during World War I on the front, the tactic of decimation. They would shoot every 10th man. In other words, they substituted for a trial system where the rules were known and perhaps lawyers could get around it, the pure chance of a lottery. And it seems to me that if the elite were ever subjected to a lottery by some kind of social vengeance function, so that if they happen to fall in this category, doesn't matter how many lawyers they buy or what they sign, but if the balls fall in a certain way, the social vengeance function can create the level that says it's not worth breaking this law. Because capitalism, as Wolfgang Streeck says, is a perpetual incentive to go around the rule, to find out what the rule is, and then say, all right, now how can we not do it, whatever the spirit is, so that we can find the most profit of it. That's a continual imperative. That means that laws are continually going to be broken, and one has to have a way to deal with them. So instituting a social vengeance function, which of course no elite would accept, it would have to be instituted by violence, seems to be one essential solution for making a polity work. There has to be a consequence if they break the law, because there's no incentive not to break the law at the moment for an elite, because the consequences are so little. So what do you think is the prospect for some version of Camilla's idea or something equivalent?
Look, I just want to clarify. I'm not in favor of the death penalty, okay? I just review John McCormick's work that actually does. However, I am in favor of social vengeance, not conceived in this manner. I think there is a problem with the criminal justice system in general, that the elite get off the hook, doesn't matter what they do. So therefore, there needs to be a way to punish them that is bypasses the regular justice system, at least in terms of corruption, okay? Corruption today cannot be really prosecuted. If we think about, you know, how to put someone in jail for corruption, you need to trace the money. And you cannot really trace the money today. Maybe if you do it correctly, you will not leave any traces. You can, you know, deposit it in some, you know, tax haven, or, you know, put money in 10 more years, or, you know, hire, you know, the family in your corporation. There's so many ways to, you know, give benefits to someone in a corrupt manner. So basically, even if you are inherently corrupt and everything that you do is corrupt, it's very difficult to put you in jail anywhere. Okay, and when this happens, it's scapegoat, right? You have one person, exemplary punishment, you know, this person is corrupt, and then we're done with. However, the system doesn't change. And I wanna give just one example. In Chile, we have the famous very corrupt law of fishery, okay? That basically gave monopoly of extraction of the sea to only the big companies that were operating, and basically deprived artisanal fisheries of the right to, you know, extract. So basically from the beginning, all the communities were against this law, everything was terrible. Today, after like almost 10 years, we have a senator in jail who actually received payments by one of the companies. However, is the only person that is in jail. All the other people that voted in favor of the law are still in office, and the law is still in, you know, is valid in a way. It has not been abolished, you know, it has been, you know, repealed, because there's no really connection, at least, you know, in our understanding, between a corrupt, you know, act, an exchange, and the product of it, the law. So if there's no connection, and I think the people, if the people would, you know, impeach someone, or, you know, judge someone, or there is a kind of evidence, and there is an independent investigation by the tribunate, by, you know, an institution that is not captured by the elite, but actually could be a random selection of citizens, as you know, the latest citizen convention in France just showed that it's a very reliable method to actually come to, you know, common sense conclusions and basically force that verdict on the justice system and see how it, and then you have a challenge there on how to respond, because if the rich and powerful have the justice system on their in their pocket, then it's going to be very difficult to get them in jail. However, you have a counterpower that can bypass that stronghold basically and force people into jail. Then you will have kind of a punishment that cannot be controlled, and it would work kind of as a kind of a random selection of shooting every 10 men, because you never know if you're going to have, if, you know, evidence is accumulating against you by basically people and on very different levels, and basically the case is being built against it, and nobody's going to save you, because if the people say that you're guilty in a way. They're not going to kill you. I don't think the state should have that power, but that's another conversation. But basically, at least the punishment that would be a fine in order to kind of deter future corruption. But I think that great deterrence is the judgment of the people, the plebeian vengeance and the plebeian founding power. Machiavelli actually kind of fuses both the constituent power and these kind of vengeance powers, avenging power of kind of like getting the record straight. For him, nothing, not even 10 years should pass before, you know, one of these punishments or mass trials as the Romans have them should occur, because then, you know, systemic corruption and the powerful get too powerful to fix it without more violence.
I don't believe in the death penalty either, but it does make a wonderful science fiction story. Imagine a plebeian force that, unknown to the person who is about to be accused, assembles a case and then sets off with its army to gain, to imprison this person and put them in jail. But it does suggest a kind of constant struggles of medieval or Renaissance cities in Italy, as opposed to what we have now. Aziz, you look like you have.
Yeah, I guess I wanted to jump in just to say that, you know, I rarely think of myself as a lawyer, but the lawyer in me did want to just add that, you know, personally, also deeply opposed to the death penalty. I also think that there's a profound value to the basic principle of innocent until proven guilty. And I think our politics should be built around dismantling the carceral system. With that said, I do think there's a problem that's a general problem, you know, of the political class across many different states, but I think you see it in an extreme version in the US, in part because of the, you know, ideas of American exceptionalism, the notion of the US as sort of the central power in the world, which is the systematic impunity that elites enjoy when they engage in state violence. And frankly, you see this from police violence on the street that led to, you know, the mass protests and rebellions over the last few years, to Gina Gaspel, you know, supervising the torture of detainees and then ending up as head of the CIA, to the fact that, you know, children were effectively disappeared at the border with no consequences for anybody that participated in those programs. And, you know, this is an issue not just of obviously the Trump administration. This is a systematic feature of the American state, which is officials enjoy impunity when they engage in violence. And that requires a solution. Like, no truly democratic country can operate in which you have security personnel at every imaginable level that can engage in violence and face no consequences. So we have to think seriously about it, but I think we have to think seriously about it in ways that are still consistent with, you know, abolitionist principles.
Agree, hard agree.
I'm not sure if this is consistent with abolitionist principles, but, you know, and I oppose the death penalty. My feeling has always been that if we're going to venerate the founders and the American Revolution, then we should follow their deeds as well as their words. And of course, the revolution got started in 1765 by just pulling people's houses down, you know, and burning their furniture. And we might try some of that.
Well, we are during the George Floyd rebellion anyway. I think I'll end with one last question here, which is from the audience. It's for Aziz actually, but be interesting to hear everyone's reactions. Aziz, what you propose is very exciting. How much do you think the Trump presidency created a temporary obstacle by driving some on the left to celebrate and defend the Constitution? This began soon after his election, but culminated with the impeachments. Perhaps not a veneration of, but a defense of the Constitution. And how do we get over that and move beyond that, I guess would be the question.
Yeah, it's really interesting. I think that the Trump presidency did two things with respect to the Constitution specifically. And actually, I mean, in a way, this is a microcosm of what's happened more generally. So on the one hand, you know, I think there's a recognition that the constitutional system is broken. And, you know, it's a massive problem that, for example, a president that did not win the popular vote was able to nominate and get confirmed to the Supreme Court three justices. Since the 1960s, the Democratic Party, despite the fact that Democrats have won, what is it now, seven of the last eight presidential elections, have only been able to nominate and get confirmed to the Supreme Court four justices. The Senate is fundamentally broken. The filibuster, you know, you can go on and on. And these are now just, I think, pretty ubiquitous talking points. But on the other hand, you do have what the questioner was noting, which is, you know, just take the first Muslim ban. You know, there was this amazing moment of popular energy, you know, the idea of people going to the airports to engage in protest. I mean, spent a lot of time, LaGuardia would not, or, you know, JFK would not willfully choose to go to JFK. So it's an incredible moment of popular energy. But one of the things that came up repeatedly was this idea that the Muslim ban violates our constitutional creed, like the principles of what we are as a country. And I think it can be really difficult, even for people on the left, to break from a very specific mid-century Cold War politics of both venerating the Constitution and then through the Constitution, venerating essentially a liberal story of the US as free and equal from the founding. And so I think this is a moment basically for us, you know, that think of ourselves as part of the left, to recognize this basic tension and to try to, you know, to confront that tension and to break from some of the common patterns of argument that even people on the left find themselves falling into. So one can defend, for example, principles of religious toleration or free speech without necessarily, you know, valorizing the Constitution. These are principles necessary for any free and democratic society. And that's the goal. It happens to be the case that we are not now and have never been a democratic society. And so we should not venerate the institutions that impose the existing forms of subordination, but instead hold firm to the principles that we think would actually be consistent with transformed institutions.
So that's why the story we tell about ourselves and the way it has been disrupted, led by things like the George Floyd rebellion or the Dakota Pipeline and stuff, what people of color have been able to do in America is profoundly uncomfortable to make that necessary move, which in essence is ending whiteness. And as a kind of, I speak as a class Marxist, you know, to say that one has to disrupt that story to even make a new story of whatever or what we are. And that's provoked so much resistance that it's very interesting to think how to deal with that. Anyone have anything else to say, or should we?
Something about the Trump administration that we, at least my book owes so much, because basically the idea of thinking about the US Constitution or any liberal democracy as systemically corrupt, did not sell well under Obama, okay? But after Trump was elected, it just, you know, everybody was, became very hot immediately. So that is something to be thankful in the sense that Trump, the good thing that he did was basically unveil how things work. And he was very blatant and vulgar about it. For example, one of his last speeches, he said that why that he didn't feel bad about not paying any taxes or basically making so much money while, you know, other people are suffering, because basically this is how the system works. I would be a fool if I don't take advantage of the rules of the game. And therefore it makes obvious that the constitution, in a way, how it is built in this minimalist way, it could be wielded and weaponized in any direction. And this is something that we need to kind of be very aware. And as Aziz was saying, there is this culture of veneration, but also to the rights to something that is, you know, trans-state in a way. It is something that is, it is in every constitution. And therefore, I think one thing to look at is not to look at inside, is to actually look at international law and international agreements, because there is where the real vanguard is, because there are agreements that are not really binding, but that there are kind of binding, and they have this ethos that could be compared to, you know, what the kind of the democratic ethos of the United States is in terms of the rights of children, the rights of nature. So much is happening all around in comparative constitutional law. And therefore, I think we need to look out in order to kind of like fix the rotten, you know, a system that Trump unveiled with all his pushing the limits and kind of showing how law could be used to oppress people and to discriminate in a very explicit fashion.
Idea for a next anthology that you can all corroborate, how we went from a constitutional law professor to a serial lawbreaker, and how our first, what's the phrase, that the first lady is the first lady? Is there a phrase for the president that begins with the first, our first citizen? How the effect our first citizen have on the story that we tell about ourselves? What's interesting about Obama is it had absolutely no effect. And he seemed to have no notion that the Constitution itself was in trouble, or that everybody was breaking the law at every level. And you expected him, having taught constitutional law, to maybe make that a focus of his attempt to rally people behind him. No, I don't. We'll save that for another Red May, I think. Richard, do you have a last thought?
No, I agree with the assumption of the question, which is that I think of all the damage that Trump did to the country, I think convincing the left or the liberal, you know, part of the population to rally not only to the Constitution, but to the FBI, for God's sakes, to the CIA, you know, is high at the top of the list. I just think maybe we don't have that much time, because I think that in the other, you know, problem that was done with the Trump era is convincing us that he was the problem and that ousting him solved it. And I think we're already seeing in the passage of these horrific voting rights revocations in many states that the effort is underway to overthrow the next election as well. And, you know, my only thing is that, you know, should that happen, we need to have all options available. But I hope instead the country takes the turn that Chile has taken and that Aziz is urging us to take towards reconstruction and renewal.
Well, let's leave out that hope, but also we'll say that we will have panels about fascism in the future at Red May. So we'll be able to talk about that eventuality as well. Thank you very much, Camila Vergara, Aziz Rana, and Richard Kreitner, for a discussion that I would love to continue in a bar, but I guess I'll have to drink alone tonight. I wish you all a happy evening, or what is it? No, it's actually 11 o'clock. You will be going to bed soon. So to our viewers, I would say come tomorrow to, we're having, let's see how, at 3 p.m. we have a panel on starting a socialist feminist woman's magazine. Nope, I'm sorry, that's Saturday. All right, let me back off. I'm reading off of my iPhone. I got it wrong. Yes, tomorrow, Friday at 3 p.m., Lux, starting a feminist woman's magazine. At 6 p.m. in the evening, theorizing the present, the revolutionary foresight of Black communist women, with Therese Burden Stelly, Jody Dean, and Ashley Farmer. And on Saturday, Spectre Journal is presenting a panel on the Paris Commune 150 years later, with Stathis Kouvalakis, Carolyn Eichner, Zachary Levinson. That's 11 a.m. in the morning. Paul North and Paul Ryder are going to talk about their New English translation of Capital at 3 p.m. And on Sunday, we're having at 11 a.m. in the morning, We Still Want Everything, a panel about Danny Balestrini's book, 50 Years Later, with Rachel Kushner, Bifa Berardi, Maria Teresa Carboni, and Jasper Burns. So a lot of good stuff. Give, if you can, on the donate button on our website. And thank you for tuning in.